I will show you.
Let my people go.
When did you get here?
I am telling you the truth. You were looking for me because you ate the bread and had all you wanted. Not because you understood my miracles. Do not work for food that spoils. Instead, work for the food that lasts for eternal life. This is the food which the Son of Man will give you because God the Father has put his mark of approval on him. What can we do in order to do what God wants us to do?
What
God wants you to do is to believe in the one he sent.
What miracle will you perform so that we may see it and believe you?
What will you do?
Our ancestors ate manna in the desert. Just as scripture says, he gave them bread from heaven to eat.
I am telling you the truth. What Moses gave you was not the bread from heaven. It is my Father who gives you the real bread from heaven. For the bread that God gives is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world.
Give us this bread!
Give us this bread! I am the bread of life. Those who come to me will never be hungry. Those who believe in me will never be thirsty.
Now I told you that you have seen me, but will not believe.
Everyone whom my Father gives me will come to me. I will never turn away anyone who comes to me. Because I have come down from heaven to do not my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And it is the will of him who sent me that I should not lose any of all those he has given me, but that I should raise them all to life on the last day. For what my Father wants is that all who see the Son and believe in him should have eternal life. And I will raise them to life on the last day.
The people started grumbling about him because he said, I am the bread that came down from heaven.
This man is son of Joseph, isn't he? We know his father and mother. How then does he now say he came down from heaven?
Shalom, Mishpoka, the family of Yahuwah, and to those who are coming in through the door of the shepherd as the one new man and Messiah in the last day's revival and restoration of all things, and the spirit and power of Eliyahu. In part one, we learned that confessing that the Messiah did not come in the flesh has a solid interpretation that only can be revealed through the Ruach. This mystery is to those who are seeking him because they, like myself and others, crave for the living bread from Shamayim and thirst for the living waters, my rock of salvation. The anti-Messiah spirit is manifesting into unprecedented proportions worldwide. Not one person is immune. The Babylonian matrix is a construct of sin. They are the adversaries of the divine instructions, the doctrine of Messiah, and the marriage covenant made only with Yasharal. The aim of this system is to take advantage of your ignorance and the lack of the knowledge of Yahuwah's word. They know the word and are experts in twisting the scriptures to keep you out of covenant standing with the Most High. Who ascended into the Shamayim and who came down as the living bread from Shamayim? Who has gathered the wind with his fist? Who has bound the waters in a garment? Who has established the ends of the earth? What is his name and what is his son's name, if you can tell? Father's name is Yahuwah, and his son's name is Yahushua, the Aleph and the Tav. Every word of Yahuwah is pure, tried, refined, and tested, according to Proverbs 30, verse 4 and 5. We learned that John the Immerser was the Zadok high priest who prepared the way of Yah for the messenger of the covenant, Yahushua. These are the two anointed ones of Zechariah 4, the two olive trees on the right and on the left of the menorah lampstand. These are the two anointed ones who stand by Yahuwah of the whole earth. Yahuchanan, John, was the immerser of the Tevilah of Teshubah, meaning his ministry was of the repentance and purification from all uncleanness and profane. He kept the Zadok calendar and lived in Qumran.
Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long, we are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
The supernatural and prophetic method on how the manna was given as a substance. It's like pictured here. There's water above, water below, and then you have the haretz, the earth in the middle. The firmament below, the firmament above. Numbers 11:9. And when the dew came down on the camp by night, the manna came down on it. So just like in creation, the dew came down in the morning, and then the manna did not fall on the surface of the desert. The dew protected and kept it clean from impurity, so it would remain set apart as Kodesh. Just like our Messiah, he was set apart as Kodesh, never sinned, kept all the commandments of the Father. In Exodus 16:14, when the layer of the dew ceased from descending from around about the camp, and see, on the surface of the wilderness was a small round substance as fine as frost on the ground. So there was water underneath, the manna was in the center, and then there was water above it. Here's a better example that I'm going to show you. So the water mist above, manna from Shamayim in the middle, and water mist below the ground. Water mist below on the ground, protecting the manna all around. The characteristics of the manna. Exodus 16:4. And Yahuwah said unto Moshe, behold, I will rain lechem from Shamayim unto you. Exodus 16:31. And the house of Yahshuael called the name thereof manna. And it was like coriander seed, white, and the taste of it was like wafers made with honey. Manna is the name of the Israelites gave. It was manhu. And if you can see right here, the coriander seed, it's all beaten up, whelped, and it's bruised up. Numbers 11:7. And the manna was as coriander seed, and the color thereof was the color of bdellium. If you can see, beloved, this looks like a piece of steak beat up. You can see the veins here. This is setting you up just so you can see what the Messiah went through. Coriander, H1407, strong. Comes from H1413 in the sense of cutting, coriander seed. Transliteration, gadad. To penetrate, to cut, to attack, to invade. John 6:51. I am the living lechem which came down from the Shamayim. In Isaiah 53:4, it says, surely he has borne our sickness and he has carried our pain. Yet we esteemed them plagued, smitten by Elohim, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised, beaten for our iniquities, and the chastisement for our shalom was upon him. And with his stripes we are healed. The living manna was beaten for our substance. John 6 verse 54. Whoever eats of my flesh and drinks of my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. You know, it wasn't just going and picking up the manna in the morning and just eating it. It took work. You had to really beat it down. The manna, you had to put a lot of work into it to get the nutritious substance that it had. The Father sent everything that the body needs in that manna, but it had to be, it took work. Here we see Messiah, he was beaten and he was bruised, and he was, just like the definition says, you know, he was brutally beaten with these whips that pull, when they hit, they pull your skin back. And his back, it looks like a stake. Isaiah 52:14. His appearance was so disfigured beyond human likeness. This was very intense to look at. Thank you, Yahushua. Thank you. Thank you for laying down your life for me, for paying for the death penalty position that was upon me, for breaking Yahuwah's Torah. This actor, he's not Yahushua, but he did a great job, and it doesn't do any justice for what really went down that day. I just want to give thanks to Yahushua for laying down everything for me and for you. As Isaiah says, his appearance was so disfigured beyond human likeness. Wow. Yet it was the will of Yahuwah to crush him, to put him to suffering, so that he should put his soul as a guilt offering for sin. He, the Messiah, is our substance, and he will see his seed, you and I. The Messiah is the Aleph and the Tav, the first and the last, the unchanging eternal one. The Aleph and the Tav is found in many Hebrew scriptures throughout the Tanakh, but is left untranslated in English. And like we learned in the first part, the Aleph and the Tav is a covenant marker, meaning that Yahushua is present. The manna in the desert, before being consumed, it had to be bruised, beaten, and crushed, just as Messiah was, that you just saw. In the same form, HaMashiach was beaten and crushed for our transgressions, against the divine instructions called his law. The will of Yahuwah shall prosper in his hand. We learn in Numbers 11 verse 8 that the people went about and gathered the manna and grounded it in meals, and beat it in a mortar, and baked it in pans, and made cakes of it, and the taste of it was of the taste of fresh oil. In Exodus 16:31, we see that the covenant marker is present with the house of Israel and the manna that came down from heaven. And it gives us another hint that the taste of it was like wafers made with honey. So the word is sweet as honey. Isaiah 53 verse 11, and he, the Father Yahuwah, shall see the travail, the pain of his soul, and he shall be satisfied. Through his knowledge of the Torah shall my righteousness servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities, the transgressions against the Torah. So it was the Father's will to bruise him this way. In Romans chapter 5 verse 1 it reads, in Messiah we are acquitted and declared not guilty by emunah, by faith, belief, and trust. And then we are to turn to righteousness, fulfilling our marriage vows daily and exceeding our righteousness past the Pharisees. We know that the Pharisees kept vain traditions of men, as they still do today. In Revelation 22 verse 13, he says, I am the Aleph and the Tav, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the ending, the first and the last, the unchanging eternal one. In Psalms 89, we read about Messiah and his seed, which is you and I who believe and follow him. It says, I shall establish his seed forever. This is the Father speaking. And his throne as the days of the heavens. If his sons forsake my Torah, my doctrine, my instructions, and do not walk in my right rulings, if they profane my laws and do not guard my commands, then I shall visit their transgression with a rod, and their iniquity with flogging, with plagues, the pale horse. This is happening right now, because people have forsaken the Torah. They have walked after idols. They have made a covenant of death unknowingly. The difference is today is that knowledge is increasing, and people are not turning to him. And the sins of the world have reached his nose. We've been hearing about the manna, and in Hebrew it's called manhu. So what is it? In Exodus 16:15, and when the children of Israel saw it, they said to one another, manhu, it is manna, for they knew not what it was. And in verse 31, it says, and the house of Yahushua called the name thereof Manna, Manhu. And there we see another covenant marker right there. Manhu in the Strong's is H1931. Hu, it means it. Man is Manna, H4478. Together it means what is it? But when you look at the word H1931, it also means he, she, or it. So a deeper meaning is, who is he? He is the Aleph and the Tav, the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last.
Where is he?
Do you believe in the Son of Man?
Who is he, Master, that I may believe in him?
You're seeing him. It is he that is speaking to you.
believe.
Make way there! Make way, the priest is coming!
Out of the way, clear the way, the priest is here! Harakuk is here.
This lying cheat was never blind.
What?
We of the temple know that he only pretended to be blind in order to earn his living.
He's right. He's a liar.
I've known him a long time. He's never been blind.
And what's your story? That you can give sight to the blind?
I came into this world to give sight to those who cannot see. And to take away sight from those who can.
What do you mean by that? That we who are righteous are blind?
If you were blind, you would be without sin. But since you say we see, your sin remains.
That's true!
The words of Messiah, the Aleph and the Tav, were like honey to this man. Just as Exodus 16 tells us that the taste of the manna was like cakes made with honey. In Psalms 119, 103, and 4, it tells us, "How sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. Through your precepts, through your commandments, I get understanding. Therefore, I hate every false way, every false doctrine, every false spirit." In Psalm 19, verse 9 and 10, the fear of Yahuwah, the reverence of Yahuwah is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of Yahuwah are true, and they are righteous altogether. They are more precious than gold, even much fine gold, and sweeter than honey and drops from the honeycomb. Messiah in the book of Revelation advises us to buy gold from him that's been tried by fire. He's talking about his precepts, his words. In Proverbs 4, 1 and 2, it reads, "Hear, O sons, a father's instruction, his discipline. Be attentive that you may gain insight and understanding, for I give you good doctrine. Do not forsake my Torah, the divine instructions, the same doctrine that Messiah taught." In Acts 7:53, when Stephen came on the scene and was rebuking the religious leaders at his time, he told them, "You received the Torah by the disposition of messengers, the Malachim, the angels, but did not watch over it." Messiah told them the same thing, said, "You received the Torah of Moses, but not one of you keep it." That's why Messiah tells us in Matthew 5:20, "For I say unto you, that unless your righteousness, your Torah keeping, exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you shall by no means enter the kingdom of Shamayim." It has been written in the Torah, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of Yahuwah." And we know that Yahuwah spoke the Ten Commandments out of his mouth, out of his lips. And Psalms 89 tells us that it tells us that Yahuwah will not break the word that has gone from his lips. These words that he spoke are the same ones that are written down in the tablets of stone, but now written in the new covenant in your hearts and in your minds. Messiah, not only is he the Aleph and the Tav, he's the horn of salvations. Through him, the two sticks of Israel, Ephraim and Judah, are made one in his hand, and they are the one new man. As you can see here, the Tav represents a covenant, a sign, a mark. The long stick represents Ephraim. The short stick represents Yehuda. We are grafted in into one of these sticks through Messiah. The Aleph is represented by an ox head. That's why they made a golden calf. They wanted to pray through the calf to the Father, and that was an abomination to the Father. And it represents leader, architect, strength, ox, and Yahuwah. The spirit and power of Elijah of the restoration of all things is taking place right now. And I'm going to ask you, which bread do you partake in? Do you partake in the bread of life, or do you partake in another bread? What covenant are you part of, life or death? The living bread of life is the word who sustains us. That is the scriptural doctrine, the covenant, and the good news. In Luke 22 verse 19, when Yahushua had taken some unleavened bread, unleavened represents without sin, the living manna, and given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. This is his sacrificed body, the Passover lamb. Do this in remembrance of me." And what he meant, this is a commandment, and what he meant is keep this in honor. Honor this Passover, that I'm making a covenant with you, that I'm initiating a covenant, as per Leviticus 23, on the 14th day of the first month of Yahuwah's calendar. John 6:51, "If anyone eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world." He's talking about the everlasting covenant. Jeremiah 16:19, "O Yahuwah, my strength, my fortress, and my refuge, in the day of trouble, the day of tribulation, the day of distress that we're living today, the Gentiles, the non-covenant believers, shall come to you from the ends of the earth and say, surely our fathers have inherited nothing but lies, vanity, and the things wherein there is no profit, no salvation. We have inherited so many lies." And that's what we're doing here today. We're exposing a lie. In John 14:24, "Whosoever does not have love for me does not keep my words." So if you do not keep his commandments, you do not love him. We love Messiah and the Father through our action, not through words. And the word that you hear is not mine, but of the Father who sent me. And that word is found in the foundation of our belief, the first five books of Moshe. Acts 3:22 and 23. "Yahushua is the prophet like unto Moshe. And it shall be that every soul who does not hear, who does not listen and do with application, that prophet shall be utterly destroyed from among the people." So whoever doesn't listen to that prophet, which is Messiah, will be utterly destroyed from among the people. You will not be part of Israel. And from the words of Messiah in Luke 6:46, "And why do you call me master, master, and do not do what I say?"
As a queen, her subjects loved her. It was a few centuries after the great flood of Noah. Noah's great-grandson, King Nimrod, turned the hearts of the people against God. One day, he came across a beautiful warrior named Semiramis and was impressed by her skills. He married her. Soon after that, he was murdered, and Semiramis became the queen. Later, she became pregnant and told her subjects that her husband Nimrod has now become the sun god, and he impregnated her through his rays. She also claimed that the baby in her womb was the reincarnation of Nimrod himself. With Nimrod elevated to the status of god and Semiramis carrying his reincarnation, she proclaimed herself the mother of God and created a false religion around that myth. He scattered the people by confusing their languages. That didn't stop the people from worshipping Semiramis. The worship continued in their new lands too. Only they called Semiramis with different names due to the confusion of languages. Before Abraham left the city of Ur, she was there. When he arrived in Canaan, she was there. When the children of Israel went to Egypt, she was being worshipped there. When they reached the promised land, once again she led astray the children of Israel. She was there in Babylon during their captivity, and Apostle Paul faced her in Ephesus. Rome knew her by the name Venus. She was the mother goddess of the pagan world. When America was founded, they came there too to establish their banks. As time went on, they launched into other businesses such as newspapers, publishing houses, theaters, silent movies, radio stations, music industry, cinema, and television. Through all this media, they channeled and molded the minds of the people into what they are today. Because of their subtle propaganda, Semiramis is alive and well, not only in USA, but all over the world once again. But the Bible predicts that this mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and the abominations of the earth, will be utterly destroyed.
Disobedience is rebellion, sin, and anti-Messiah. To know Yahuwah is to know His ways, to know His paths, to know His word, to know His divine instructions called Torah. In 1 Timothy 2:4, Yahuwah desires all people to be saved and come to the knowledge of His truth. He wants everyone to be acquitted from the death penalty position for breaking His law. Then we are to walk like Messiah walked, fulfilling our marriage vows daily, just as He fulfilled the law and the prophets. There's three categories that I'm going to point out. One takes the communion bread. These folk, their heart is right. They love Messiah with all their heart, might, and strength. The Spirit of Truth has not come upon them yet. They are in religion, and they are trying to contend to the original faith once given. They will not find it there. However, these believers, they are flexible to change. These believers need to make teshuvah, meaning they must repent. Once these believers find that they have been doing abominations unto the Father and have not followed His ways and have been following traditions of men which are vain in His eyes, they're quick to repent because the Spirit is dwelling in them, and they will return to the ancient paths of the covenant, the feasts which are His appointed days, His dress rehearsals and appointments. That is why He will say to many, "I do not have knowledge of you. I don't know you. Depart from me, you worker of lawlessness." Every Shabbat, He is waiting for you, but you bypass that day to honor Him on a Sunday. I hope you can see that. The next group is those who keep the Passover meal, the Kaddush, every Shabbat. These believers, Father has awakened them. He has awakened their DNA. They're blooming like a flower. They walk in the Spirit and in the truth of Torah, and they are doing the commission as prescribed by Yahushua. And they are flexible to change. They have submitted everything. They have given everything to Messiah. Just like Peter said to Messiah, "We have given everything to you." They have entered the covenant and renew the terms and conditions every time they do the Kaddush. These believers proclaim His name and the covenant as a testimony to all, and that's what I'm doing here today. They follow the ancient paths and have prepared to preach. They're not walking carnal. They're walking in spirit and in truth. The cares of this world is nothing to them. Material, cars, gold, material things, not interested. They hunger for the living bread and the living waters. And they, like I said, they give all because the restoration of all things is teaching us that we must prepare as a bride. The spirit and power of Elijah, the revival, is teaching us and is showing us and is leading us to make preparations, and is teaching us how to prepare for the coming Messiah, for the return of our King, our Messiah, Yahushua. Group three, they partake of the Lord's Supper. These are lukewarmers who participate with the mixture in all vain traditions of men of Mystery Babylon. They go all the way out on these feasts. Most are not flexible to change. They have entered another covenant with someone else. They follow man's doctrines and they have a rebellious spirit, and they're in the spirit of error, the spirit of anti-Messiah. The abominations in the temple, your temple bodies, because you are the temple of Yahuwah, and you are to have living sacrifices unto Yahuwah daily. Ezekiel 8:3 tells us that the image of jealousy, it provokes Yahuwah's jealousy for his people, meaning Yahuwah is jealous when they have wandered away and serve another mighty one. And what is this image of jealousy? There you go. They follow after their mother in Rome. Ezekiel continues that they are weeping for Tammuz. Tammuz represents the sprout of life, and he was resurrected. According to the pagan traditions, he was killed by a pig, and when he was resurrected, he was a reincarnation of his father Nimrod. We know that Yahushua is the sprout of the stem of Jesse, who was David's father. In Ezekiel 8 verse 16, they were bowing down themselves eastward to the sun. They were worshiping the sun instead of Yahuwah. There's nothing new under the sun. Today, the deception is so rampant and so great that I didn't know I was a sun worshiper. I mean, I partook of all these things too. Ezekiel continues in verse 17 and 18, and he says, "And they put the branch to their nose." And as you can see, there is an olive and a tav, meaning there is a covenant marker with Yahushua, the Messiah, present here. He says, "Therefore I will act in wrath, and my eye will not spare, nor will I have pity. And though they cry in my ear with a loud voice, I will not hear them." Like I said, there's nothing new under the sun. We are under the time of tribulation. We must get our houses in order. We must get our belief. Again, I do not question your faith, but your belief. What do you believe in? What anointed person are you following? That's what I'm questioning. Because the time will come when the Father will not hear you. The truth is being proclaimed right now. In John 15 verse 5 and 6, Yahushua tells us, "I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me, I in him, he is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, in his word, in his covenant, in his good news, he is thrown away like a branch and withers. And the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burnt." This is exactly what John the Immerser taught too. Hosea gives us a warning and tells us some truth here. In verse 13, he tells us, "Woe unto them, for they have fled from me. Destruction unto them, because they have transgressed against me. They have broken Torah. They have broken covenant. Though I have redeemed them," meaning I have purchased them, I have delivered them from the death penalty position, "yet they have spoken lies against me. They return, but not to the Most High." In Jeremiah chapter 23, 3 and 4, he tells us, he gives us hope here. There is hope. There is light. To those who have eyes and to those whose hearts are being pricked, he says, "I will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the countries where I have driven them. and I will raise up shepherds over them who will shepherd them in the true good news, in the covenant, to walk in the spirit and not carnally, to know the difference between clean and unclean, the profane and not profane. But in order to do that, many claim to be the remnant, but they're not walking in covenant. Only the remnant that are adhering to the divine instructions will be part of this flock. And as everyone knows, our ancestors, especially here in the United States, are not from the United States. They're from all over the world. So he scattered us to this country, but he will gather us. He will gather us, not a rapture, a gathering. A gathering out of the 12 tribes who are in covenant with him. We know we've all partaken of this tradition, that we have seen no harm in it. But in the eyes of Yahuwah, it was an abomination. Truth versus pagan traditions. 2 Kings tells us straight out, 17 verse 41. So these nations feared Yahuwah. They had reverence for the Father and served their graven images, both their children and their children's children, as did their fathers. So do they unto this day. Meaning, right now, because the word is alive, it takes on the past, present, and future tense. Unto this day, this is taking place. This is still happening today, just like it did back then. Nothing new under the sun, except more sophisticated now. That's why in Hosea 4:6, he tells us, my people perish for the lack of the knowledge of Yahuwah, because you have rejected the knowledge of Yahuwah. I also reject you for being priest to me. Since you have forgotten the Torah of your Elohim, I will also forget your children. Point to be made here. We are royal priests in Messiah Yahushua of the order of Melchizedek. So this verse definitely applies to us. When we reject the Torah, we reject Messiah. So when we speak lies against the Torah, we're speaking lies against the Most High. Before he gathers us out of the nations, out of the countries where he has driven us, he's going to set up shepherds, as he's doing right now. He's setting up new shepherds. These pastors, these rabbis that you're listening to, some of those are not of Yahuwah, and they are not teaching the truth. They're mixing truth with falsehood. So in order to know who's teaching what, we need to be attentive to the Ruach and test all spirits. In Leviticus 26, verse 14 and 15, he tells us, for breaking my covenant, I will also do this to you. If you know the Father, you know that if you love him, he'll love you. If you hate him to his face, he'll hate you to your face. Just like he tells us in Deuteronomy 7, that if you hate him, he will not delay to destroy you to your face. Just like Messiah says, I will tell you to your face, I do not know you, you worker of lawlessness. That is the way the Father is. If you love him, he'll love you. Jeremiah 10 verse 2, do not learn the way of the heathens, the Gentile nations, that do not guard the covenant made with Yisrael. In Acts 14 verse 16, it tells us, and in past generations, Yahuwah allowed all Gentile non-covenant nations to walk in their own ways. But the times of this ignorance Yahuwah winked at, but now commands all, every one of you, everywhere, to repent and to return to the ancient paths, to guard the covenant, to contend to the original belief that was once given. Ephesians 4 verse 17, so this I say as a witness in Yahushua, that you should no longer walk as the nations walk, in the futility of their thoughts and understanding, meaning they produce no valuable effect towards the covenant and towards the good news. In Jeremiah 7 verse 18, the women need their dough, to make bread, the cakes for the Queen of Heaven, Ishtar, Semiramis, Ashtaroth, and they pour out drink offerings to other gods, the Lord, Baal, to provoke me to anger. The Lord in English is Baal in Hebrew, and Tammuz is the resurrection of Baal. Tammuz goes by many names, just like his mother Semiramis. Jeremiah 7:19 asks us a very important question. Is it I whom they provoke, says Yahuwah? Is it not themselves? To the shame of their own faces. And 2 Esdras 1:27 confirms that. He says, you have not as it were forsaken me, but your own selves. In other words, you have not forsaken Yahuwah, you've forsaken your own self. So I urge you to examine your belief. And to examine what doctrine you're following. What spirit are you following? Because we also know there are cakes for the Queen of Heaven. Just like the Manna tasted like cakes made with honey to the children of Yisrael. Yahuwah's Pesach and Unleavened Bread versus Easter. The resurrection of Tammuz. Pesach is when Yahushua initiated the new covenant with Yisrael, the two sticks made one in his hand, not with the Christian church. They must repent of their Gentile ways and confess Yahushua and walk as he walked.
The cup of Hallel, the cup of praise, that all who believe in him will drink in God's kingdom when we are gathered unto him. The Lamb of Egypt spared our firstborn from God's wrath. So Yeshua's blood poured on our hearts, who caused the angel of death to pass over us in the hour of judgment.
Judah, Judah, why are you the only rabbi who knows the truth? When our forefathers were delivered from Egypt and everyone witnessed the exodus of our people, what has your Messiah done except divide our people?
You know as well as I do, Yitzhak, that there are many priests and Pharisees who believe that Yeshua is the Messiah.
And all of you tailor the scriptures to say what you want them to say.
You know the scriptures as well as I do, Yitzhak. Tell me, what word have I changed?
What makes you so sure? What makes you so utterly convinced he's the promised one?
Because I was there, Yitzhak. From the miracles to the cross. I was by his side. I saw those miracles. I heard him speak the words of God, his Father. I saw the pain. I was there when he was crucified. Witnessed heaven's tears. I saw it all.
This is a wake-up call for the Christian community. In scripture, Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread are together as one. They are one package. Unleavened Bread is when Messiah was in the belly of the earth for 72 hours and resurrected on the weekly Shabbat on Yahuwah's calendar. He was first seen on the first day of the week, and he is the first fruits of our emunah. The Easter celebration on Sunday morning is only the resurrection of Tammuz, not the Messiah, based on the moon calculation. Semiramis, Ishtar, Easter is the moon goddess, the queen of heaven, the great mother who bore Tammuz, who was killed by a pig. In Rome, there was the cult of Ishtar, and there she was the protectress of the temple prostitutes and the patroness of the alehouse. Today, the harlot causes Yah's people to drink the wine of fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk, according to Revelation 17, verse 2. The day of testimony is the resurrection day of Messiah, who is our first fruits of our faith, trust, and belief. Revelation 12, verse 17, and the remnant of her seed, Yasharel, the bride, which keep the commandments of Yahuwah and have the testimony of Yahushua the Messiah. The day of testimony, the correct resurrection day, is what these believers follow, and that is they are witness to the testimony of Yahushua that he died on the 14th day of the first month. If you do not partake of the living bread, which came down from Shamayim as part of Messiah's specific instructions, you do not have the testimony and do not bear witness to the truth. I am your fellow servant, first fruits in Messiah, and of the brethren that have the testimony of Yahushua. Worship Yahuwah in Ruach and in truth, for the testimony of Yahushua is the spirit of prophecy, which is outlined in the menorah, the appointed feast, the dress rehearsals, the appointment days. These are appointed times. These are specific or appointments that he made, like when you make with a doctor. The appointment has been made, and it's up to you to make that leap, to be obedient, to be flexible, to be obedient to the Father. We are to no longer walk as Gentiles. And we confess Messiah, not by our mouth, but through our actions. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 3 and 4. And indeed, if our good news, the Bezora, has been veiled, it has been veiled in those who are perishing, in whom the mighty one of this age has blinded the minds of the unbelieving, the disobedient ones, the ones that reject and speak lies against the Father. I'm bringing up Luke 22:19 again because when we're learning, repetition is good. This needs to sink in that Yahushua, when he took some unleavened bread and he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, keep it in the proper instruction that I give you. Yahushua is the bread of life and is the resurrected master of the Sabbath. Ishtar, Easter, is the bread of death, and Tammuz is the resurrected Lord of the Sol Invictus, the unconquerable sun. In John 14, verse 24, whosoever does not love me does not keep my words. Again, you can say that you love Messiah until you're blue, but if you do not obey him, you hate him. Because he is the prophet like unto Moshe. And again, every soul who does not confess, who does not listen, who does not hear, that prophet shall be destroyed from among the people. This is a warning from Stephen to us today. Leviticus 26, 14 and 15. And if you do not listen to me, and you do not do all these commandments, and if you reject my statutes, and if your soul hates my judgments, so as to not do all my commands, to the breaking of my covenant, I will do this to you. We are living in the times of tribulation, and if you're not walking in covenant, you will get the wrath of Yahuwah, and he will not hear you. There is a controversy of the 14th day. In In the New Covenant, Yahushua, the sinless lamb, kept the Passover on the 14th day of Abib on Yahuwah's calendar, according to Leviticus 23, verse 5. He instituted the covenant as a commandment and began the restoration of Israel, the Yashareel, as a spiritual house, offering up living sacrifices in the order of Melchizedek, with the same terms and conditions, but now written in their hearts and minds. This instruction was followed by the early disciples. Remembering the death of Yahushua on Passover, according to Torah, is of a major importance to Abba. And in about 155 AD, which is about 125 years after Yahushua's death, this controversy started. Now, when I was pastoring in the Christian communities, I was told by other pastors that the resurrection was more important than the death. Both are important to the Father. But yes, the resurrection is very important, but the death is also, because that's when he instituted the covenant. Polycarp was a disciple of John the Revelator, and he could not persuade Anicetus, who was the head pontiff of the Church of Rome, and he was trying to persuade him to observe the Passover according to Torah. But Anicetus said that he ought to follow the customs of the presbyters that had preceded before him. So the Roman pontiff preferred to follow the vain traditions of men that had preceded him. Now, Polycarp celebrated the Passover the proper way, as he had received it from the first apostles of Yahushua, who taught Torah. The vain traditions of the bishops of Rome were of greater weight than the example Yahushua gave. The leaven of the Pharisees, the hypocrisy, will continue until Messiah returns. The spirit of Semiramis, Ishtar, Easter, was present in Rome. She was called Sibylle in Rome. The Romans knew Sibylle as the Magna Mater, the Great Mother. The Roman Catholic Church calls herself the Mater, the Great Mother, and she has daughters. In 325 AD, the Council of Nicaea, which was assembled by the Emperor Constantine, was the first ecumenical council of the Christian Church that made Easter official, which impacted the Shabbat. Beloved, Constantine had nothing to do with Yahushua. He was not a believer. He was pagan all the way. He never changed. And this ecumenical of the Christian Church, that was Christian. That was not Nazarene. And this council of the Christian Church did not include the Ruach HaKodesh of the Father Yahuwah. Mystery Babylon seduces the sheep. You know, this mother harlot, this great mother, she says, I sit as a queen and I'm not a widow. Even though she has daughters, she says she's not a widow. This same system that has been operating under the spirit of Ishtar, this matrix, it thinks to change times and laws, meaning it thinks to change the Moedim, the feast of Yahuwah, and the laws of the Torah, the Sabbath being a perfect example. And for this reason, her plagues will come in a single day. That's why Yahuwah, that's why I'm pleading with you, come out of her, my people, lest you partake of her sins, lest you share in her plagues, which are coming upon the earth right now. And more are coming. 1 Corinthians 5:8, it says, so let us celebrate Pesach, not with the old leaven, not with the old man nature, not with the traditions of men, not as Easter, nor with the leaven of malice or wickedness, but with the matzot, with the unleavened bread of affliction, of sincerity, of love, free from hypocrisy, and in truth, of Yah's word, ways, paths, and Torah doctrine. Many pastors will tell you.
The question for today is not candy. It is candy. It's Easter baskets, bunnies, egg hunts. What is a Christian to do? We spent a lot of time trying to figure out how to phrase this question.
We did.
But we're talking about these traditions.
Because it seems silly. What seems silly about this is that sometimes I think we can make this kind of a witness test. If you're really serious about the gospel, then you won't let anything get in the way of celebrating the season for what the season should be. First of all, you know, let me just say this. We don't want to just celebrate the idea of a resurrection one day a year. It's something that should inform everything we do all the time. And so what I would say about what should Christians do with Easter baskets, bunnies, and egg hunts is enjoy them. But don't ever let them take a place that pushes what should be the focus of our entire lives, and especially what we as Christians celebrate as Easter weekend.
Easter cannot be Passover. It's a different feast, separate. It has nothing to do with Yahushua. Jeremiah 50, verse 6, my people have been lost sheep. Their shepherds, their pastors have led them astray. They have forgotten their resting place. All who found them have devoured them. And this is true. They have taken advantage of them. They become rich and they become poor. They suck money out of them. So the Father now is setting up new shepherds that teach Torah, that teach the true doctrine, that teach the good news of the Bezorah, that if you do not turn from your ways, that you will perish, that you will end up in Gehenna. Ezekiel 34, verse 11, but thus says Yahuwah, behold, I will both search my sheep and seek them out. And here again, we have a covenant marker, the Aleph and the Tav, with Yahushua's presence. It'll be Yahushua who will gather the sheep, the lost sheep, as he foretold. He says, I come only for the lost sheep of the house of Yisrael. So I urge you to be grafted in into the vine and come out of the traditions of men. Yes, you have been saved from your past sins, but now you must come to the knowledge of the truth. Because Yahushua tells us, my sheep hear my voice, my sheep keep covenant, and I know them, and they follow me, and they walk as I walk. The tablets of the ordained division of days in the Shamayim, the feast, the appointments of the covenant, the Sabbath, Passover, and Resurrection Day are all feasts of the covenant. We are to try to keep as best as we can to follow them without leaven, without the traditions of Judaism or Christianity or paganism, but according to his word. Yes, most of us are in different calendars, but our inclinations are correct, and the Father sees this, and it is he who judges our hearts. In Jubilees chapter 6, 34 through 38, it reads, for I, Moses, know, and from henceforth will I declare unto you, and it is not of my own devising, for the book written before me, and on the heavenly tablets the division of days is ordained, lest they forget the feast of the covenant, and walk according to the feast of the Gentiles, after their error and after their ignorance. For there will be those who assuredly make observations of the moon, how it disturbs the seasons, and it comes in from year to year, 10 days too soon. Both Judaism and Catholicism use the moon as their main calculation for their Passover and Easter keeping. For this reason, the years will come upon them when they will disturb the order, and make an abominable day of the day of testimony, and an unclean day a feast day. And they will confuse all the days, the Kodesh with the unclean holy day with the Kodesh day. For they will go wrong as to the months, as to the Sabbath and the feasts and jubilees. Moshe tells us that they will treat the day of testimony, which is his resurrection, as an abominable day. They will treat it as common, as it is today. And they will call the Kodesh day, the set apart day, as a holy day, which is a pagan word. Holy is a pagan God's name. For this reason, I command and testify to you that you may testify to them, to blow the shofar, to blow the trumpet as I am today. Matthew 7, verse 23, and then I will tell them to their face, I had never had knowledge of you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. Remember, Yahuwah repays those who hate him to his face by destroying them, according to Deuteronomy 7:10. Adam ate the wrong fruit. Moses struck the rock instead of speaking to it. The father is serious about following his instructions. He is no longer winking. He is serious. This is the last generation that will be judged according to the truth, according to Torah. The Ark of the Covenant, your testimony, your confession, and your love of Messiah. This is the inside of the Ark of the Covenant. And inside the Ark, we found three items. The two tables of stone, the bowl of manna, and Aaron's rod that budded. The 10 marriage covenant words, the tables of stones, are the terms and conditions of the marriage covenant in the original covenant and in the new covenant that are now written in your hearts and in your minds. The tables of testimony bear witness against us. The Shabbat is the sign of ownership between us, between us and Yahuwah. The tables of testimony are written in our hearts and minds as a sign that Yahuwah's Torah instructions is in our mouth. Just as Shaul, Paul quotes in Romans 10:8, that this is the word of emunah, faith, believe, and trust that we proclaim. This is our confession that we make when we partake of the covenant. The manna represents our works with Messiah and us. The manna represents Messiah's words that dwells in us and sustain us as the living bread. The manna also represents eternal life, the eighth day of Sukkot. Aaron's rod that budded represents the Melchizedek high priest and the king of righteousness who inspects, judges, and weighs our works in the balance. We are a royal priesthood under Messiah Yahushua. It also represents the anointing, the authority and power over sin and the anti-Messiah spirits, demons. In John 5, 7 and 8, for there are three that bear witness, the Ruach, the water, and the blood. And these three agree as one. And these three agree as one on the compassion seat on the Ark of the Covenant, what made atonement for us. It was not the cross that made atonement for us. It was the Ark of the Covenant. If we accept the testimony of men, how much greater is the testimony of Yahuwah? For this is the testimony of Yahuwah, which he has testified of his Son. This is the record that Yahuwah has given us eternal life. This is the record that Yahuwah has given us eternal life in the Son, Yahushua. In Daniel 9:24, it tells us that Yahushua would make atonement for iniquity, and he would bring everlasting righteousness, and he would atone the most kadosh place. This is represented by the seat of the Ark of the Covenant and Messiah himself, because he was anointed too, and he is the most HaKodesh. He is the most Kodesh. Four parts to a covenant: a proposal, an acceptance, blood ratification, and a consuming meal. Four parts to Messiah's covenant: the proposal, to take and eat of his body, to eat of his flesh, to do this in remembrance of him, as per Leviticus 23. Our acceptance is our confession of faith, trust, and belief that we will hear and do the 10 words that are written in our hearts and minds. The blood ratification is the Lamb's blood on our heart's doorpost. The consuming meal is the Passover meal. The unleavened bread, wine, and lamb on Abba Yahuwah's calendar. Hebrews 10 verse 29. How much worse punishment do you think will be thought worthy to receive the one trampling the Son of Yahuwah, and having counted the blood of the covenant as common, in which he was set apart as Kadesh, sanctified, and having insulted the Ruach HaKodesh of unmerited favor? There are four parts to an anti-Messiah covenant: a proposal, to do this in remembrance of Ishtar and Baal, as per the Council of Nicaea, that you will hear and do the Ten Commandments as per the mother harlot. The blood ratification is that the blood is treated as common, just as the day of testimony is treated as common, the day of the covenant. The consuming meal is when you partake of the Easter bread cakes, the wine, and the Easter ham on Sunday morning at the image of jealousy on the Roman Gregorian calendar and not Yahuwah's calendar. 1 Corinthians 11:27. Therefore, whoever eats of this Passover meal and drinks the Kadosh cup of Yahushua unworthily, to treat it as common, shall be guilty of the body and the blood of Yahushua. According to 1 Corinthians 5:7, we are to purge out that old leaven, cleanse our body, temple body, of all sin, that you may be a new dough, having no indication or fermentation of sin, as you are indeed like unleavened, uncorrupted by sin and the world with Messiah in you. More than that, Messiah or Pesach has been sacrificed for us on Passover, not Easter Sunday. We are living in the last hour. The last hour is upon us now. We must get our houses in order, our spiritual house. Revelation 12, verse 17, and the dragon was enraged with the woman in the wilderness. The wilderness represents sin, and went away to make war with the rest of her seed, those keeping the commandments of Yahuwah and having the testimony of Yahushua the Messiah. The dragon, Satan, Gadrel, he hates that we have come out of Babylon and keep the correct feast, the correct dates to be in covenant with the Most High. 1 John 2:18, children, it is the last hour, and just as you have heard that the anti-Messiah is coming, so now many anti-Messiahs have appeared. This is how we know it is the last hour. And I can confirm to you that there are many anti-Messiahs, and the anti-Messiah one is alive. John continues in verse 19, and he says, they went out from us, but they did not belong to us. For if they had belonged to us, they would have remained with us. But their departure made it clear that none of them belonged to us. Just like Judas Iscariot, he was a type of anti-Messiah. There's many in the belief that call themselves believers that have gone from us and are going from us right now, and they do not belong to us. For if they had belonged to us, they would remain with us, meaning they would have eyes that hear and ears that hear, and would come to repentance. What they have been doing was an abomination to Yahuwah. And Deuteronomy 32 confirms in verse 31 through 33, for their rock is not as our rock. Our enemies are void of understanding, for their vine comes from the vine of Sodom and from the fields of Gomorrah. Their grapes are grapes of poison. Their clusters are bitter. Their wine, their doctrine, their covenant is the venom, the spirit of serpents, and the deadly poison of asp. The asp are the false teachers who teach against Torah. And yes, they are void of understanding because the spirit of truth has not come upon them. Of course, this is why there's three groups. There's some that are flexible to change, but there's some that are not. I pray that you are flexible to change and that you examine your belief. In verse 20, John tells us, but you have been anointed by the Kadosh One, the Most Set Apart One, and you all have knowledge, meaning you all have Torah understanding in application, unlike those whose rock is not as our rock. Their understanding and knowledge is of the world, is head knowledge, not heart knowledge, not spirit knowledge, not ruach knowledge. I write unto you, not because you do not know the truth of Torah, but because you do know it, and because no lie is of the truth. And Psalms 119 verse 142 tells us that Yahuwah's Torah is the truth. And finally, my brothers and sisters, in 1 John chapter 2, verse 22, who is a liar? But the one making denial and claiming that Yahushua is not the Rebbe, the Rabbi, the Malek, or Sovereign, the HaMashiach, the Messiah. This one is an anti-Messiah, the one denying the Father and the Son.
Kneel before your God, Babylon!
Mystery. Babylon the Great.
Babylon the Great. Mystery. The habitation of devils.
The mother of harlots and abominations of the earth.
The mother of harlots and abominations of the earth.
Drunken with the blood of the saints.
Drunken with the blood of the saints.
Habitation of devils and the hold of every foul spirit.
By thy sorceries were all nations deceived.
By thy sorcery
were all nations deceived.
By thy sorcery
were all nations deceived.
By thy sorcery were all nations deceived.
Her sins have reached unto heaven.
Her sins have reached unto heaven. Her sins have reached unto heaven. Reached unto heaven.
And Mishpoka, I leave it right here. I pray that you come along with me again to part 3, where we crucify the anti-Messiah spirit. In Yahushua's name, Shalom.